normally I would not start a lecture with any personal comments, but I'm going to, for reasons you will see, you'll understand. The first is that this is the first time I'm in Istanbul in 49 years, and this time, of course, I come as an adult, and it has been very moving for me emotionally to be here in the place where my father and mother grew up and about which they talked incessantly. So that walking the streets of Istanbul is like walking through the 50 years of conversations between my parents that I have listened to. They asked me where I wanted to be taken, and I said, Yüksek Kaldır. Yüksek Kaldır. And they said, why? And I said, because in my parents' conversation from childhood, I kept hearing them say things like, Minas, do you remember the cake place to the right of Yüksek Kaldır? Kohar, do you remember Lale Çiçek Evi of Istiklal, etc., etc. So for me, walking through Istanbul was like walking through my parents' life. It was very moving, and I'm very glad to be here. Second, around the later part of July, I became very sick, and my face was paralyzed. This is now passing. It's a kind of paralysis that eventually passes. But the entire left side of my face did not work. I can't see out of my right eye. So that limits the effectiveness of my speaking. I hope that since my speech has returned, I hope that I'm clear to the translators and to the rest of you who know English. Normally I would give a long keynote lecture, but today I'm going to try to make a series of points. I want to say that I will not be talking about Armenian diaspora identity in its many hybrid forms. I'm not going to be talking on Armenian homeland identity, or even about ethnic and national identity generally. Those entities will be implicit in much of what I say, and later on I'm happy to take questions, but right now what I will offer you is that what we call an overview of scholarly debates about identity in the Anglophone world. This debate has certain points in common with what we would think. Baron Mogadishian just actually gave a very good account of most of the points that would come up in such a discussion. So I'm going to be talking more about the view of scholars that does not come up in normal conversations. In the year 2000, two important American scholars, Rogers Brubaker and Frederick Cooper, published a long article. Its title was Beyond Identity, in which they argued that prevailing notions of identity are proliferating, multiplying, but they have lost analytical purchase, that is their language. They present a detailed argument which concludes that we can observe and analyze behaviors, we can register affinities and affiliations among people, but we cannot fix their identity. Because, they say, affiliations change, commitments change, actions change, and describing this complexity of collective behavior at work, we can do it without saying, oh, this is because of their identity, that's not because of their identity. That is to say, they say, they can describe collective behavior, which is what scholars do, without referring to the word identity. In their last paragraph, they conclude, it is now time to go beyond identity. Not in the name, they say, of that imagined universalism, which they reject along with essentialism, but in the name of conceptual clarity that is required for social analysis and political understanding alike. Now notice, this is the most important conclusion of the most influential recent article in English on identity. It says, go beyond identity. We do not need identity to do our work. I'm not going to go beyond identity today, but I'm very aware, everyone should be aware, that Brubaker and Cooper present a strong analysis. Much of what is said and done today with the vocabulary of identity can, in fact, be done better and more clearly without it. Nevertheless, the concept of identity is not going away, and that is why we're here. I will begin by saying that the underpinning all discussions of identity is a duality, a binary, that is often not articulated in debate. It is an ancient binary, and the English form is being versus becoming. Being versus becoming. It goes back to the pre-Socratic philosophers beyond Plato. Strong concepts of being claim that universally, at the core of every identity, there is an essence, a quality that is the raw material of identity. At the other extreme, there is no unchanging being at all. Life is a constant becoming. Life is something created along the axis of time by doing, by acting, and what is done by people or to people establishes their individual or collective identity. The next important feature of the prevailing discourse, so I'm going to be talking about some binaries that are behind the discourses. The next important feature of the prevailing discourse of identity is that it's again split, and this is between those who work hard to understand individual identity, the identity of each person, and this is opposed to those who work hard to understand collective identity. Psychologists, psychoanalysts, literary writers, many intellectuals, and young people are intensely interested in issues of sexual and racial identity, and they participate vigorously in discussions of individual identity. The other category, which is made up mostly of social scientists and government analysts, focuses on collective identity, whether that identity is territorialized on a homeland and governed by its own government, for example, Turks in Turkey, or whether that identity is diasporized, or whether it's transnationalized and guided by changing mechanisms along real and virtual digital networks. This kind of identity, that is to say, an identity which does not depend on being on this land governed by your own government, this other kind of collective identity includes what we call textual communities, like Islam or Judaism or Christianity, communities where a sacred text is at the center of communal identity. But it also can include, for example, Hinduism or what is now called global China and other emerging transnational communities. I must insist, because I come from the American Academy, on the importance of those who focus on individual identity, even though I must also add that no one can think well if you think just about individuals. Always, when you look at scholars or at individuals, you can see that they are making assumptions about family and about society, and that these are also necessary components of such thought. But the focus is the formation of the individual's identity and subjectivity. There is a very large conceptual vocabulary that you will encounter in Anglo-American identity discourse about the individual. I'm not going to discuss the many terms in detail, but I just want you to know what some of the terms are that always occur when you discuss individual identity. Some of them, Baron Mugurdichan already described. Memory is one of them, inevitable. One term which is self-reflection, the mind's ability to think about itself and to change its opinion about itself. Others are subjectivity, interiority, individuality, selfhood, personhood, consciousness, and then associated with consciousness, the Freudian or psychoanalytic unconscious, that is to say the claim that no individual identity can be formed without an unconscious as well as a conscious section. Sometimes people use the word psyche, as in psychology, and even those who are more moralizing use the term character. So individual identity is spoken of in all these terms from slightly different perspectives. Furthermore, because there are fashions, there are moda, as you say, right now in the United States, because of the Black Lives Movement, because of the transgender movement and other reasons, feminism before that, what has become very important that you don't hear about very much in Armenian discussions is the body. That is, people say you can't just talk about identity as though it's something abstract in consciousness. You have to talk about the body. The body of the individual and the meanings that are mapped onto it, that are projected upon it, matters in the debate about individual identity. For example, intellectuals will ask how a racial identity is mapped onto the biological chromatic reality of skin colors. Being black is a biological chromatic fact. Having a black identity is looking at a body and projecting upon it a set of social meanings. But those meanings don't exist independently of the body. And the consciousness which is in that body comes to understand itself both in terms of its physical body and what is projected upon it. Feminists, of course, say that the body of women has functioned in the same way, and that the body of white males also functions in the same way, but white males aren't aware that that's what's happening. These debates can be very fierce. I'm not going to review them in any detail, but I want you to know that one of the fundamental problems is whether collective identity is the sum total of individual identities, whether the collective is a product of individual identities, or the individual identity doesn't exist until the collectivity projects an identity on the individual body and constructs it. So really it's impossible to talk about identity without talking about an exchange or an interchange. I'm emphasizing the individual identity because in my experience, in most Armenian discussions, it seems to be absent. The emphasis in this kind of discussion is on what's called reciprocity or interaction, the back and forth, with the individual having an important place. In addition, the vocabulary of identity in the United States and England has the vocabulary of what is called performance. We speak of the body performing its identity in social space. And a question that immediately follows this is what personal and social scripts are either authored or found to be available for performance, how these performances are interpreted, etc., etc. What this means is that there is an argument that you don't have an identity sitting back there. You have that identity when you take the script of that identity, the way an actor reads a script and enacts that role, performs that role. So that identity to them is a matter of internalizing a script and then performing it. There are people like myself, for example, who are bicultural. When I'm an American professor sitting with other American professors, I have a script of how to act like an American professor. That's what I do. I perform my American professor would. When I'm with Armenian friends, of course, it's the same person, as we say, but the script of identity which I perform is a different one. That's called being bicultural. Social scientists prefer to speak in terms of constructing identity, but many activists who emphasize the individual prefer to speak of performing identity, believing that the individual may have some choice, some agency in the choosing of his or her own scripts. And there's a long academic tradition going back to J.L. Austin and to Judith Butler, where the concept of performing identity into being through language and the use of the body as sign has become a prominent way of thinking about identity. I'm going to skip the next paragraph. At this point, you may wish to accuse me of creating binaries in an unreasonable way. It is surely the case that the binaries are never completely isolated from each other. Every focus on individual identity assumes and presumes the power of family, social practices, discourses, and institutions. By contrast, every social scientist who focuses on the powerful formative role of institutions in developing collective identity constantly runs the risk of assuming that individual identities are either non-existent or unimportant, assumes they are plastic. Their plasticity means, as in plastic, they will take any shape that the social gives to it, and runs the risk of assuming that individual identities are either non-existent or plastic, and therefore neglects individual agency and ignores the friction of the individual identity against collective identity. I do not have time. time to discuss these problems in any further detail, which I may not wish me to, but I wanted to make sure that you understood that at least in the milieu, intellectual milieu in which I work, this individual identity is considered very important. And that identity is always, therefore, an interactive term, the product of an interaction between individuals and collectives, between individual identities and collective identities. And personally, I have no doubt that identities are constructed. But being a literary person, I also believe that they can be deconstructed, rearranged by both individual and collective agency. Time changes identities and time freezes them into place. The greatest work on identity done by a psychoanalyst is done by Erik Erikson, who was a student of Freud's. He rejected Freud's notion that we are mostly formed by the age of five and thought that in all but the most exceptional cases, individual or personal identity, like sexuality itself, is shaped by the end of adolescence, so somewhere between 16 and 18 years. But he struggled all his life, for example, in his analysis of Martin Luther, to find examples of a transformation of identity in middle age. If Brubaker and Cooper commented on Erikson, and as far as I know they don't, I think what they would say is, look, Erikson is describing a remarkably plastic changing behavior of one very great man, Luther. And he's calling two different behaviors of Luther at two different points in time, two different identities. We, that is to say, Brubaker and Cooper would say, we don't see why he needs the term identity. He is describing, they would say, a remarkable change in behavior in late middle age, which we rarely see. But we don't believe that there was an identity to be changed. There was behavior that changed. That's the very large division that nobody can fully bridge. And of course, this debate is not simply a debate about individuals. I will quote you as an example something that the British journal The Economist published in 1967. In 1967, there was one of the several wars between Israel and the Arab nations, and as you may recall, the older ones among you, the Israelis won the battle in 6 days. It was a great battle. And the British reporter in The Economist, reporters don't sign their names, so I don't know who it is that said this, he said, once in a while, you have this amazing change in collective identity. So not just somebody like Luther changing his personal identity, but collective identity. He said, let me quote, until World War II, the Jews were the great commercial nation. Now, he was pointing on the battlefield in the Sinai, they have become the great warrior nation. And until 1945, the Japanese were the embodiment of the samurai warrior spirit. And now, they're the world's great new commercial nation. The claim there was that collective identity, like individual identity, can sometimes change quite rapidly. We don't really understand how that happens. Of course, exceptional circumstances are involved. When we speak informally about the Armenian people, we say first that the conversion to Christianity from paganism changed us as a nation, changed our national identity, and we think of the genocide as changing our national identity. Again, Cooper would say our national behavior. At this point, what I'm going to do is do something a little bit like what Mr. Wittgenstein did, that is, I'm going to talk about some individual discussions of identity, collective or individual. In my view, no discussion of identity, individual or collective, can be serious without mention of memory. Mr. Wittgenstein mentioned it. But the lines of investigation of memory are many. Ever since the year 1690, when John Locke wrote his famous an essay concerning human understanding, the definition of personal or individual identity has always depended on a notion of personal memory. It has been thought to be constitutive for the formation and maintenance of individual identity. And to this memory, later thinkers said, just as memory constructs identity, amnesia can deconstruct identity. Just as memory and speech constructs identity, memory plus silence changes identity. So silence about experience as well as speaking about it, remembering and choosing to forget, both shape memory. Commemoration, what the French call the construction of lieux de mémoire, sites of memory, disait Malaperte. Intentional or unintentional forgetting. a psychoanalytic unconscious, which combines repression and forgetting. All of these are various forms of memory manifesting itself, both as present as it is as absent. There is, in other words, no serious possibility of thinking about individual or, in my view, collective identity without thinking about memory. In the journal in which I edit, we publish articles in which people mention what Mr. Higutyun said, that is, a diaspora that is formed out of genocide and has the memory of genocide is different from a diaspora that is formed out of poverty and emigration. What is remembered is different, and the formation of the collective identity is therefore different. Next, as a person who decades ago was trained, as I was originally, in what was called narratology, I will add that arguably the most potent forms of memory are those shaped and disguised as myth, narrative, story, embodied, impersonal, familial, folk, artistic, and scholarly narratives. That is to say, memory necessarily takes narrative form, and the different genres of narrative differently shape how your individual or collective identity is perceived. If there are universals that are common to all humanity, as far as we know, there are three. The first, as both Freud and Claude Lévi-Strauss said, is the incest taboo. The second is music, and the third is narrative. And narrative is formative of all identity. No discussion of identity, individual or collective, can, again in my view, be serious without the study of difference. All identity is relational, and the relationships that count most are relationships of difference, especially at the border or boundary of individual and collective being. Whether you're reading a structural linguist like Ferdinand Saussure or an anthropologist ethnographer like the Norwegian Frederick Barth, both say one thing in common. Most colloquially, we can say that no notion of woman is complete without the lazy idea of difference between man and woman. That is to say, our notion of the one thing very often depend on an assumed difference from the other things. I will here interject that there was an old woman who was my babysitter when I was a little boy, because my mother as well as my father worked. This is in Aleppo, Syria. And one day, I asked her the formative form of the question, so you're Armenian and we are, and I'm Armenian, I'm a little boy, I was four, but we're very different. What's the difference? So, that was identity. I'm an Armenian, I'm not a Dajik. You are, that's it. That difference is the foundation of your identity. In scholarship, the binaries of sex and race are binaries of difference, man, woman, white, black, and at certain times others have prevailed. In European history, I'm a Catholic, not a Protestant, or vice versa. I am a Jew, not a Christian, and vice versa. No identity without a structure of difference in semiotic systems. And the question, therefore, one of the questions we have to ask is, if you're a Brazilian who identifies as Armenian, and you're a Beirutzi who identifies as an Armenian, is your other, is your different, the same different, or is it, if not, then your identities are different, depending on how you posit that. I will just mention that, of course, no discussion of identity, whether individual or collective, can be serious without mention of language, but that's already been mentioned by Baron Lugavichian, and I just want to talk about language in another way a little later on. As a subsidiary of the discussion of identity, something that is developing now is a way of thinking that is being published, but I have not had the time to spend a lot of time reading it. I'm just going to give you an idea of it quickly, therefore, superficially. This arises from the seminal works of the French sociologist Pierre Bourdieu on the notion of habitus. We don't have time to discuss that now. And seems to be arguing that even as we learn language, we all know that we learn language somewhere between 8 months and 2 years, we also learn alongside language, now I will quote, a series of dispositions, of course it's an English translation of Bourdieu's French, a series of dispositions mental and cognitive structures, ways of being, feeling, and even carrying oneself physically that are not consciously designed. End of quotation. Some of these things, ways of being, feeling, cognitive structures, are inscribed in the body itself, others in language, and they render the distinction between individual and collective identity irrelevant, according to people who do this kind of work. It is not clear to me whether those who are developing this idiom of Bourdieu think language is indispensable to such learning or not, but they do seem to be suggesting that the learning of habitus is a kind of environment, but it's no more the environment outside you. When I say I'm in this environment, I mean I'm me and there's the environment. But Bourdieu shows powerfully, studying, by the way, the Berbers of Morocco and Tunisia and Algeria, the Kabyle Berbers, he says, there is no such thing as the environment and you. You become you by learning how to behave in that environment and take a consciousness of that environment inside you. We say habit uses the Latin word habitus. You don't just learn language. You learn the environment that is physical, you learn the environment that is social, and it's inside you. As you grow up, just as the language, your knowledge of the language grows, so does your habitus. It's in you. So now we have to talk about identity in terms of habitus, but as I said, I have done only a little bit of reading in this area, so I'm not going to say anymore. In my view, no serious discussion of identity, whether individual or collective, can succeed without taking into account institutional practices, of which the most famous is religion. Of course, institutional practices can involve the government or the state, but also non-state entities. In his discussion of the Armenian past, Razmik Panosyan names the conversion to Christianity as a factor in Armenian national identity. Significantly, he points out that the actual historical events of conversion matter less than the narrative of that conversion created by the church and disseminated after the invention of the Mesrobian alphabet, until a century later, with the depiction of Vartan and the Battle of Avaraj, Christianity became woven into the prevailing definitions of Armenian identity. I would only add a little note of caution that, of course, for about 1,000 years, Armenian historians and religious writers don't mention Vartan and Avaraj. Vartan and Avaraj grows and grows until about 500-550 AD, and then stops being mentioned most of the time until the 1700s. So the church uses it, stops using it, and goes back to using it. One important aspect of religion is that it creates, freezes, and repeats sacred ritual. This is very clear in Jewish identity, where the rituals are very successfully moved into the family. So that you don't even have to go to a synagogue. In the family, much of the religion is passed on in ritualistic form. And this ritual is undoubtedly hugely important in the maintenance of identity, because ritual changes much more slowly than everything else. A Jewish family sitting to a Seder dinner in New York today says prayers very much like what they said 200 years ago, although they're not similar in any other way. Panosyan also discusses the writing of history emerging among Armenians in the 5th century as an important feature of a form of narrative practice that becomes an important agent of ethnicity. Mr. Panosyan, myself, the historian Sebu Aslanian, and others have also discussed the emergence of identity as not always taking place in the homeland at one time, but something that happens that is polycentric, that takes place in different centers, and can be multilingual, not just in Armenian. Armenian identity was invented not just in Armenia, but in Venice and Vienna by the Mkhitarists, in Nurjuba and Madras, in Istanbul and Tbilisi. This is something that we really we all know this, but we don't internalize it fully, that Armenian identity was not simply formulated in a homeland. It is, of course, the homeland is indispensable in many ways. As Baron Mugredichian says, a real or an imagined homeland is still indispensable. But it is outside the homeland as well as in it that national identity is invented. This is still a rich topic, and I think it's just beginning to develop. And one of the questions is whether, as, for example, Israel, the idea of Israel and the idea of Zionist Jewish identity was invented in German, in Vienna. Okay, so I don't know how much of Armenian identity in the future will be formed in languages other than Armenian, in places other than Armenia. I have absolutely no way of guessing. I just want to say, remember that that happens. Let me end by summarizing my own view of identity, which I came to in my own analysis, but which I will summarize here by quoting the French philosopher Gilles Deleuze, who says it better, and for once he says it clearly. He argues, like Stuart Hall and 100 other scholars, that it would be better not to think of identity, but of endless processes of identification. So identity is not static, we endlessly learn identifications. And these changing of identification, Deleuze says, I'm quoting now, brings into play three elements. Brings into play three elements. I mean, we can go to the moon, but we still can't make a loudspeaker that just uniformly does what it should do. And a man who does what he should do. He says they bring into play three elements. Here are the three elements of all identity, according to Deleuze, which is also my view. One, he under the number one, he puts several words: a form, an image, a representation, a portrait, a model. That is some representation, whether in words, pictures, narrative, other, musical, that says this is an identity. And then it says that to a subject. A subject in this language means abstract subjectivity that is not yet formed into identity. That is to say, what precedes identity is, and this most psychoanalysts would agree, a virtual subject. I didn't move my head that time. So the first necessity is this thing which we can call a form, a representation, a model. The second is a subject that wants to model itself. And the third is the subject's effort to assume a form, to appropriate an image, to adapt itself to the image, and the image to itself. End of Deleuze. So I would say, therefore, that discussion of identity involves first these models that sign systems offer. Language is the first one, but there are others that offer to you a model. This is how you can be a man, a woman, a black man, an Armenian. These most prominent representations are, and this depends on time and place, one, we should not underestimate it, government history books in countries where school teaching is governed very strictly. Government history books shape people's identities, but also forms of propaganda. That is to say, probably the most famous example for scholars, have you ever seen a movie called Chushimura or The 47 Ronin? The 47 Ronin is the story of how a proper samurai behaves. In Japan, the story of the 47 Ronin was central to education. And you can trace a line from the Ronin to the kamikaze diving in their planes into, before there were terrorism bombers with a bomb going into a crowd, there were the kamikaze with one bomb diving into the American aircraft carriers. That's the ideology of the Ronin, the samurai suicide. And that was taught. I mean, the story was always in Japan, but it's only after the militarization of Japan that the Japanese said, the model way for a Japanese boy to grow up into a Japanese identity is to internalize the samurai identity, the bushido, the readiness to die for the honor of Japan. That was government, not just individuals passing on that ideology. At other times and places, films, television, importantly musical narratives, popular myths, literary fictions, all of these are available. My students tell me that many of them get their notions of a really cool identity by what is curated on Facebook. That is to say, they read how other people present themselves on Facebook and they re-edit their Facebook profiles to fit that identity because I think that's the one that's coolest. Don't underestimate the importance of this. This is the future that I don't understand well. I only understand it because I teach 18 to 22-year-olds all the time. And they come in to talk about literature or literary theory, and we end up talking about Facebook or Instagram. Also, as Magdalena Magdalena mentioned, online identity is now a major phenomenon. Just in my own work, I've been reading on Chinese, Indian, Turkish Alevis in Germany, very important studies, Eritreans from near Ethiopia, Haitians, and others who have reconstructed their identity
in homeland and diaspora online. Probably the most interesting such account I've read is by a Taiwanese Chinese who teaches at Berkeley in California, a major American university, who studied cyber identities of Chinese. And she was quite disturbed by it. She said that when you see Chinese people, whether in Hong Kong and Singapore and Taiwan or in the United States or Peru or wherever, they're real people in real situations who they discuss their identity, both in relation to their memories of China, to their sense of Chineseness, but also the locality in which they live. This is what normal human beings do. She says that what online identity does is that it disassociates, it separates, it disassociates people from their local identities. And suddenly, he says, you can see them elaborating, constructing a computer identity which is stripped of all the human links to locality, and it's abstract Chineseness. We Chinese are such and such a people. We are that. And not that there's necessarily something wrong with it, but she is disturbed by it because she thinks that the identity that's being constructed collectively online is not actually a true identity. Nobody actually has that identity in life, but that's being made the privileged identity by the power of online. Scholars and intellectuals need to have a theory of the existing subject. Who is the subject that says, I need and desire and must have an identity? So there are two theories. One is you're just a tabula rasa, and your identity is projected on you by your parents, your family, your society, your government. The other is no. There's never a tabula rasa. There's already a subject there, but it's a virtual subject. It's a potential subject. It's not yet a realized kinetic subject. And the theory is that the virtual subject desires an identity, desires an individual identity that fits into collective identity. The starting point of these analysis is by the French psychoanalyst Jacques Lacan, who has a powerful insistence that from infancy on, we are dissatisfied by what he calls le corps morcelé, literally the disarticulated body. And he says that our selfhood is shapeless and we desire identity. We find it in language and other systems of representation. There, Lacan is the model for what Deleuze is saying. We find that identity in linguistic and other systems of representation, and we either think we recognize ourselves in them or we want to be in them. Lacan believes that this notion of recognition is, in fact, not recognition, but what in English is called misrecognition, méconnaissance in French. He says we are so needy, so desperate to have a coherent identity, individual or collective, that we embrace, he actually says, we jubilantly embrace, jubilantly, with great joy. Finally, I found an identity I can have and belong to. And that this misrecognized, impossible identity, we internalize. So we take it from the outside, we internalize it. And Lacan says, pessimistically, we spend the rest of our lives trying to live up to that identity, and we cannot, because it's not actually a real possible identity. It's like that Chinese identity constructed on cyber, in cyberspace. It's not what a person can live by. So for Lacan, he's a pessimist in the sense that we desperately need and want an identity. We get one, we internalize it, and when we spend our lives suffering because we can't live up to that identity. I'm finishing. I would say that my own theory of the formation of individual and collective identity always involves this strong need to have one. Even people who think they don't need to have one or they already have one are searching for one. That I believe in the necessity of describing the half-formed subject that aspires to fulfill the requirements of a form, a model, a script, a representation of identity. I would add this with the Canadian philosopher Charles Taylor, that we will also demand recognition of that identity. Once we have assumed it, once we have said, this is us, we want others to recognize us and to address it, us through that. And Taylor says that a positive recognition is indispensable. You cannot do without it in any relationship of identity. He actually is drawing from Hegel there, but that's a long story. But it is the case that in many analyses of identity that I read, I don't find sufficient recognition of the need to not only construct an identity, but have a certain kind of other recognize that identity as such. I will stop there. Thank you very much.